Good morning. Well, actually, good afternoon. Welcome to our live lunch and learn. I'm going to start it off with a little song here from Ivy Hisson entitled The Election. Check it out. Ivy Hisson, The Election.
They believe in obligatory salvation, not American grace. It's salvation because, it's election because, it's atonement because, and it's perseverance if. It's salvation because, I believe, it's election because God saw us choose. It's atonement because I accept it, and it's perseverance if I continue. And that's a pitiful, prideful set of doctrines. The elect are elect because of grace. They are elect because they are known by God. Because they are set apart by God. It's because they are beloved in the Father for no other reason than it seemed right in His eyes.
I chose God when He chose me. He the potter, I'm the clay, He the mold me. He decided to let me die to the old me. It didn't take a prophet because He shows me. Through His word, my brother, He told me, repent, believe the gospel, live holy. So He enabled me to drop on my knees and plead for salvation, grace and mercy. Everything that I do is only because of Him. To the next breath that I breathe, the use of my limbs, to the way that I think, decisions that I make. He's never ignorant to none of my actions. Hey, He ain't sovereign, but zero tolerant. When it comes to sin, I like God again. For Christ paid the price for the sins of the ones He elected from the foundation of His life.
Don't ever draw the conclusion from the sovereignty of God that inactivity is rational. It is irrational. It does not mean that God will approve of the policies of the man who gets elected. This is extraordinarily crucial to understand.
Jacob, I love, but Esau, I hate it. That's what God said before they was even fully created, so that the purpose of election could be demonstrated. Some of you would say He's not fair, but He's the greatest. Who are you to question why He does what He does? Many people say the same things, but you can judge. Either the word softens you or hardens your heart. Either you damn like hell or you set apart. Either you see or you're blinded. Either you hear spiritually or you live in the silence. Yeah, He has mercy on who He has mercy on. I just thank God for His grace. I was all alone, stuck in my sins, drunk off the gin, but He pulled me in, called me His friend. Christ paid the price for the sins of the ones He elected from the foundation of His life.
The idea of predestination is not an overstatement. There are people who hate the thought of divine election, sovereign choice. In fact, there are some people who say that the doctrine is demonic. The doctrine itself is satanic. For many people, rationally, it seems unfair.
The word of God is only for the elect. Jesus died only for the elect. He felt neglect only for the elect. For God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son for the elect. Do you follow me yet? It's His will that none perish, none of His elect. You see that whosoever is His elect. We've been predestinated from the foundation of this world age. Those that's not is gonna feel God's rage. Yeah, no, you can't say a prayer, go to an altar and say you've been saved by the Father. I don't care what you felt or if you got emotional. Romans 10 and 9 is taken out of context, you know. And I ain't trying to discourage you, but the truth hurts. Salvation is only a supernatural work, and Christ paid the price for the sins of the ones He elected from the foundation of His life.
For God to foreknow is for God to forecommit Himself. It is God to forelove, to forechoose. It means before the foundations of this world, God sought you out, made you His own. He's known you the way a husband intimately knows a wife. And I'll tell you this. You got people from every corner today that want to run out and cheapen this word foreknow. Rather than see it as the knowing, the intimate knowing God look through history and stop with belief. They desecrate the word. That is not what it means. People try to cheapen it all the time. Then God chooses those whom he sees will believe on him. But let me ask you this. When God looks at all of mankind, can you find any text in the Bible anywhere that says God looks through time, sees who will believe, and chooses them? It's a figment of men's imagination.
Amen. Amen. That is Ivy, his son, with the election. And by that song, I guess you probably know where our text is going into today. It's going to deal with election. If you're looking for a church home and you're in the Maryland area, why don't you come by Hope Bible Church, pastored by Pastor Tom Leake and Pastor Alan Plumley and Pastor Tony Gadula. It's at 7185 Oakland Mills Road, Suite A, Columbia, Maryland, 21046. That's Hope Bible Church. You can check us on the web at www.hopebiblechurch.org. You can go in there and listen to sermons and all types of audio. You can also watch them on Ustream. Also, you want to check out the His Word, His Way broadcast. We have three of the brothers there that have shows on there. There's Minister Daryl Kendrick. He comes on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, 6 a.m. to 6:30 a.m. Central Standard Time. If he was talking to p.m., that'd be a long time of talking, brother. And we have Brother Alfonso Neal. He does the Tuesday night Bible study for His Word, His Way, 7:30 to 9:30 Central Standard Time. That's Central Standard Time, okay? And Real Talk Thursdays, 7:30 to 9:30 Central Standard Time. Pastor Seiko Woods hosts that. You want to check that out actually tonight. And the reason why is they're talking about the Puritans, their race, and their dealings with race. You really want to check that out. It's going to be discussing and having the author of a book. I can't remember the name of the book, but you really want to check that out. That's an issue that needs to definitely be discussed in the body of Christ. And we're going to kind of talk about that when we're dealing with election, too. We're going to just have a little taste of that. But I advise you to check out those broadcasts as well. www.gty.org. John MacArthur, Grace to You, comes on. Seems like you can go on the web every day of the week and get that there. All right, let us now begin in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for election. We thank you for predestining us to salvation, to his adoption as sons. Lord, let us learn to glory in that and to praise that, because that is a good thing. It is something you have already done. And Lord, we just thank you for that. It is in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay. Now, we are in part two of the blessings of purposeful salvation. Now, before, in the first part of this part, we dealt with verse 3. And now we're going from verses 4 through 14. They deal with the actual blessings. And what happens is the way it's broken up is first in verses 4 through 6, you see the prior good. In verses 7 through 11, you see the present graces. And in verses 11 through 14, you're going to see the promised gift. So what it is the past, the present, and the future. That's how Paul is presenting this doxology about God's purpose of salvation. This helps the believer in understanding his position in Christ. Now, again, you see the position seen in chapters 1 through 3 of Ephesians. In chapters 4 through 6, you see the practice. You learn the theology in chapters 1 through 3. You learn how to how to practice that theology in chapters 4 through 6. Ephesians is a great and awesome letter when you're looking at the body of Christ and how it functions, what its purpose is, and why God has us here. It also helps you to understand how to live as a Christian. You know, men make choices. They make choices and they have no control over them. For example, when you're driving on the road, someone can choose to cut you off. And that choice will either cause you to give them a little happy wave, if you know what I mean. Or someone may choose to let you get in their spot, in which it causes you to respond by waving at them and thanking them. Choices can either bring us to praise for another for the good choice or frustration for the bad choice made. Now, if choices made in the human realm happen to affect us in such a way, why would they not in the spiritual? God chooses, and his choice of the believer is something we have no control over, yet should generate a proper response from us. This is often referred to as the biblical doctrine of election, in which God, in eternity past, chose every believer that would live for him in this world. But election seems to have struck 2,000 years of controversy, which I believe the Apostle Paul will be surprised at our reactions to it. He would be shocked that we are arguing over the doctrine of election, especially when it comes to the context of Ephesians. But one thing is for sure. As believers, we should glory in the many references to God's choosing of believers. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13, it says, "But we should always give thanks to God for you, brethren, beloved by the Lord, because God has chosen you from the beginning for salvation through sanctification by the Spirit and faith in the truth." Psalm 135, verse 4, "For the Lord has chosen Jacob for himself, Israel for his own possession." John 6, 44, "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day." In Deuteronomy 7, beginning in verse 6, it says, "For you are a holy people to the Lord your God. The Lord God has chosen you to be a people for his own possession out of all the peoples who are on the face of the earth. The Lord did not set his love on you, nor choose you because you were more in number than any of the peoples, for you were the fewest of all peoples. But because the Lord loved you and kept the oath which he swore to your fathers, the Lord brought you out by a mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of slavery, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt." That is to be praised, his election. Now, in the past, we looked at the blesser of our purposeful salvation in verse 3. And we found God is worthy to be praised. We saw that he gives every believer spiritual blessings in line with the character of his Spirit. This means we cannot say, "I can't," because God has given us all that we need to walk in the Spirit. Well, we continue in our study of Paul's praise for the blessings of God's purposeful salvation from verses 3 through 14. And these blessings help Christians understand, again, their positional unity in Christ. Now, turn in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 1, and we're going to highlight verses 3 through 6. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 6. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we would be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to himself, according to the kind intention of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, which he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. We will discover why Paul particularly gives praise to God's prior election of believers unto salvation. We will see this in Paul's doxology concerning election's prior good, in looking at the basis of election in verse 4, the boundary of our prior election in verse 5, and the beauty of our prior election seen in verse 6. So let us get in here as we start off with the basis of our election. Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we would be holy and blameless before him. This is the basis of his choosing us. We're chosen. Ex alexato. It's a compound word, ek, which means out of or out from, and lego, meaning select or to choose. So it's you're picked out for one's own self, or chosen out of, or from preference and favor and love. So God chose us out of love. He chose us. That means that there was no human influence upon his choice. This is seen in Mark 13, verse 20, where it says, unless the Lord had shortened those days, no life would have been saved. But for the sake of the elect whom he chose, he shortened the days. You see, there was no human influence there. Luke 6, 13, and when day came, he called his disciples to him, and chose 12 of them, whom he also named as apostles. You see, there was no one there. No one there influencing God to choose his apostles. You also see this in John 15, verses 16 and 19, Acts 1, 2, and Acts 13, verse 17. See, Paul praised God for not choosing under the influence of wretched humans like myself. Or like you and I. It says there that he chose us. He chose the believers. God's decision was to choose believers to be saved by the work of Christ in the gospel. He chose us. His choosing of believers is a praise and not a boast. God is seen loving us, for he chose us. He first loved us and he chose us. Now, God explains this choosing was to shame those who think themselves wise. In 1 Corinthians 1, verse 27 says, but God has chosen the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to shame the things which are strong. The glorious thing about it is that he chose us in him. The realm of this choosing was located in God or in Christ. This was a security in Christ. That's why Jesus could say at the beginning of John 10:27, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give eternal life to them, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one. That's security to know that the Father has given them to the Son. You were chosen. You're safe. The entire church is embodied in Jesus Christ. He is our federal head, and we were chosen in Him. And the question becomes, well, when did He do this? There was a time that God chose, right? Well, He tells you, in eternity past, before the foundation of the world. Now, some argue that based on God's foreknowledge from Romans 8:28, God chose people at the time of their salvation. But unfortunately, this doesn't mesh well with the Greek language. So the reason before the foundation of the world is listed in the text is, Paul's thought here is, you have to look at the verb for election. It is in the aorist middle indicative, which means the choosing was a completed action in the past. Also, before is the word pro. It means that it highlights a point of time prior to another point of time. You can look at Matthew 13:35 and John 17:24 or 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 20 to see this. It's a point of time prior to another time that God chose to complete this action. And that other point in time is listed there. The foundation of the world. Literally meaning the throwing down of the universe. God already decided that we would be saved before creation. It's plainly said there in the Greek. This doctrine can be a hard pill to swallow. But I like what Spurgeon says about it. It is one of the axioms of theology that if a man be lost, God must not be blamed for it. And it is also an axiom of theology that if a man be saved, God must have the glory for it. The question then comes, why did He choose us? Now, in the beauty of election in verse 6, Paul further explains the purpose of his election of the believer. But before seeing that concept, we must grasp the moral implications of our elected position in Christ. And it says it right there, to be holy and blameless before Him. Holy meaning set apart for God's reflection of His purity, and blameless meaning to be free from blemish. What does that say? Every believer should be passionately pursuing holiness. I'll say that again. Every believer should be passionately pursuing holiness. You should be passionately searching out to live a holy life as a Christian. Ephesians 2:10, for we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. God prepared that you walk in holiness. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 7, for God has not called us for the purpose of impurity, but in sanctification. But in sanctification. Again, I can't do it is given no wiggle room here. You can't say, I can't live holy. No, that goes against Scripture. God says you can. You're my workmanship. You have to pursue the blameless life because the holy God has elected you for it. A Christian who has absolutely no desire to be holy is actually not even a Christian at all. God doesn't elect sinners to stay as sinners. He calls us to be saints. If we begin to say in our hearts that that isn't fair, well, then Paul goes on and further explains the boundary. He says, in love, he predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to himself, according to the kind intention of his will. These are the boundaries of his election. And the first thing he wants us to see is election is not election unless election is done in love. Love is the motivation of God predestinating the believer into his family. Now in your Bibles, in love is normally found at the end of verse 4. But it actually accompanies the thought of verse 5, even though good commentators believe it is carrying the ending thoughts of verse 4. It actually belongs at the beginning of verse 5. That love is agape, which silences any question to the intention of God's purpose for adoption. It makes sense for Paul to use the phrase to introduce God's divine purpose here. He has to start you out and say, wait a minute, if you're questioning whether it's fair, hold on. In love, I predestine you to be adopted. And that leads into the second boundary, where it's predestined is to the adoption as sons through Jesus Christ. This is beautiful. See, predestination means to set bounds before, to determine or decree or ordain beforehand. In Romans 8:29, it says, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his son, so that he would be the firstborn among many brethren. In 1 Corinthians 2, verse 7, it says, but we speak God's wisdom in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God predestined before the ages to our glory. The point is, God selected believers to be adopted into God's family. In other words, we become co-heirs with Christ Jesus, seen in Romans 8:17. We share in the same privileges and status, though we were wretched sinners. It's amazing because in Roman law, an adopted son enjoyed the same privileges as a real son. You see this in his adoption as son. This literally means to place one as a son. It speaks of being placed in a position of a son or daughter who now possesses the same rights as the parents' natural children. It means to formally and legally declare that someone who is not one's own child is henceforth to be treated and cared for as one's own child, including complete rights of the inheritance. Now, I want you to listen to what Barclay quotes in his commentary, because this is very insightful. When the adoption was complete, it was complete indeed. The person who had been adopted had all the rights of a legitimate son in his new family and completely lost all rights in his old family. In the eyes of the law, he was a new person. So new was he that even all debts and obligations connected with his previous family were abolished as if they had never existed. That is what Paul says that God has done for us. We were absolutely in the power of sin and of the world. God, through Jesus, took us out of that power into his, and that adoption wipes out the past and makes us new. That is the beauty of what adoption does. And Barclay hit it straight on the nail. It wipes the slate clean. What we see here in Ephesians, this could be addressing a Jewish and a Gentile people. And what is happening is they're seeing this at their time, and they're thinking how amazing the mystery is being revealed. God chose Jew and Gentile to be in the same family as his? See, remember how the Jews felt about the Gentiles and how the Gentiles felt about the Jews. There was what we call racial division. There was racial division. And adoption eliminates that. Adoption says, drop all of that. Paul is praising God for that. I'm glad that a Gentile is my brother. Wait a minute, you're a Jew. Paul, you grew up as a Jew. The Hebrew of the Hebrews, man. You remember in John chapter 4 where the people would go around the Gentile half Jew town? Remember that? That's how the Jews felt about certain races of people, certain mixed breeds. It was hatred. And now adoption said, all of that is dropped. All of that is gone. You are now brother and sister in my family. That's why I say a lot of times, and my wife knows I say this, there is no racist Christian. There's no racist Christian. Why? Because adoption eliminates that. Now, I'm not talking about people struggling because they've been used to such a culture that they're not used to being around different people. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about those who claim that they hate another race. They hate another ethnicity. Well, adoption eliminates that. It says, all of that is gone. You're brothers and sisters now. It's one of the things I like about my wife's family. When I married her, they treated me as if I was in their family, as if I was a blood relative. And I'm not. We had a friend over, and she brought her adopted daughter, and the adopted daughter is black. And our friend is white. And the friend said out of her mouth, "This is my daughter." Now, in America, some people might have a problem with that. Who? That's not your daughter. No, she said, "This is my daughter." She had been adopted into the family. It eliminated the lines of race, the lines of ethnicity. Now, that doesn't mean that there are going to be issues that come up with color. Of course there will be. But see what it does? It eliminates that. I think about when I went to California for the Shepherd's Conference, and I was staying with a mixed couple. In other words, the husband was white and the wife was Spanish. And we went to this particular restaurant that was all Spanish. And me being a black man, I rolled up in there, and there was a lot of Hispanic people up in there. And they recognized real quick, oh, wait a minute, he not from around here. I could see them looking like, whoa, don't he know where he at? But the thing was, when they saw me with the couple, they immediately got, he's okay. And I even had some of the people come up to me and say, hey, how you doing? How are you? What's going on? That's how adoption is. It eliminates that. It says we are family. And that's why I encourage you to listen tonight to the His Word, His Way broadcast that deals with how the Puritans felt about black people. That needs to be addressed. Because they had a little something, things they said about black people did not consider adoption. And see, people get kind of uptight when you start dealing with their heroes, their Puritan heroes. And you shouldn't be that way. We should kill those things and talk about these things because we have been adopted into Christ's family. The other thing about this boundary is that election has the good intentions of God's will. It is in accordance to God's good pleasure. The Bible Knowledge Commentary says He delighted to impart spiritual benefits to His children. Election is also beautiful. It has a beauty to it. And we see that in verse 6. To the praise of the glory of His grace, which He freely bestowed on us in the Beloved. So now the goal becomes clear. It's the beauty of praise. All of election is for the purpose to the praise of the glory of His grace. You kind of see a similar thing in verses 12 through and in verse 14 of chapter 1 of Ephesians. Listen to what the Expositor's Greek Testament says. God's final purpose in His eternal determinations and the supreme end to which all that He will regarding us looks are the manifestation and adoring recognition of His grace in its gloriousness. The phrase means more than the praise of His glorious grace. It expresses the setting forth on God's part and the joyful confession on man's part of what the divine grace in these eternal counsels is in the quality of its splendor, its magnificence. Isaiah 43:21 says, "The people whom I form for myself will declare my praise." You see, election is for the purpose of bringing praise, glory, and honor to God. Romans 9:23-24. "And He did so to make known the riches of His glory upon the vessels of mercy, which He prepared beforehand for glory, even us whom He also called, not from among the Jews only, but also from among the Gentiles, for the glory of God." So what election is for? For the glory of God and the praise of His grace is what election is for. What adoption deals with. Not only that, there's a beauty of the received grace. Spurgeon talks about this. He says, "There is another precious doctrine, the acceptance of those who are adopted. We are beloved of God. He has a complacency, an idea of great pleasure toward us. He takes a delight in us. We are acceptable in His sight. Oh, what a blessing this is. But remember that it is all in Christ, accepted in the Beloved. Because Christ is accepted, therefore those who are in Him are accepted." The beauty of a received grace is the Lord freely bestowed it. This means He caused the believer to be the recipient of the benefits of His grace. And that is an amazing love. That is a wonderful grace. It is election, which we should ultimately praise God for and not argue over whether it is fair or not. John 17 says, verse 22 through 26. "The glory which You have given Me, I have given to them, that they may be one, just as We are one. I in them and You in Me, that they may be perfected in unity, so that the world may know that you sent me and love them even as you have loved me. Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, be with me where I am, so that they may see the glory which you have given me. For you loved me before the foundation of the world, O righteous Father. Although the world has not known you, yet I have known you, and these have known that you sent me. And I have made known your name to them, and will make it known, so that the love which you love me may be in them, and I in them. Election is an amazing love that God wants the believer to praise, that God wants the believer to glorify. Don't argue over election. Praise God for election. Amazing love. How can it be that you, my King, would die for me? This has been Difference Maker saying to you, God bless. Stay in the Word of God. Here's a worship song for you as we end up the broadcast.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. You are my King. You are my King. Jesus, you are my King. You.